Praise the Lord, my dear wonderful friends. Thank you for tuning in to another edition of Times of Refreshing. It is indeed an honor for me to come and share God's word with all of you. I pray that the word of God that I'm about to share will impact your life and will bless you in your future walk with the Lord. I'm going to be talking about a parable that Jesus taught his disciples. 5 foolish virgins and 5 wise virgins. What made them foolish? What made them wise? Stay tuned and find out. I'm also going to be giving you a historical background about the Jewish weddings. Because in order for us to understand this parable, we need to understand how a Jewish wedding was conducted during the time of Jesus. Without understanding the background, it's very difficult to understand this parable. So we will be touching on the historical background, and then we will go into the parable to see what is the message that Jesus is trying to convey to us. Stay tuned and be blessed. Praise the Lord, my dear friends. I want to talk to you from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 25. The parable that Jesus taught his disciples about the 10 virgins who was waiting for the bridegroom. I want to talk to you today and see what we can learn from this parable. In order for us to understand this parable, we need to understand the cultural context of the Jewish wedding at that time, the time of Jesus. Here in Gospel of Matthew chapter 25, verse 1, it says like this: Then the kingdom of heaven shall be likened to 10 virgins who took their lamps and went out to meet the bridegroom. Let me quickly give you a recap of the cultural context so you can understand this parable clearly. Back in those times, the times of Jesus, in order for a wedding to happen, it was the parents, the bride and the bridegroom's fathers that would arrange this marriage. But the wedding will not happen, or the relationship will not happen, without the permission of the girl. The girl had the final say whether she wanted to marry this bridegroom or the man and their family. If the bride say yes, they will agree to proceed. They would have 2 ceremonies. Number 1 is betrothal ceremony or engagement ceremony. And number 2, the wedding itself. Now, before the betrothal or engagement to take place, the parents had to agree on 2 things. And number 1, it's called mohar, or the bride price. During the times of Jesus, it was the bridegroom that would gift the bride. He would pay or give gifts according to his standard to the bride. Unlike today's culture, today it's the bride that gives the gift to the bridegroom. But during the times of Jesus, it was the other way. And number 2, there will be something called ketubah, a marriage covenant or a marriage contract. And that marriage contract is to protect the bride. And that usually says, that it's a promise that bridegroom is making to the bride that says, I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. I will always take care of you. And if something happens to me, these are the things I will do. And so on. That is called ketubah. And once these 2 things are agreed upon, then the betrothal ceremony will happen. Betrothal, again, it's engagement in our time. The betrothal will happen. They make it public. The Jewish religious leaders will be there. And the family will be there. They'll announce this mohar and ketubah to the public. And once this they get engaged, they cannot break it. In order for them to break this engagement, they have to go get divorced. Even though they did not get married, this engagement was so serious that they were not allowed to get divorce until they go to a Jewish religious court to get the permission. For example, when you read Matthew chapter 1 verse 19, it talks about Joseph and Mary. Joseph and Mary was not married during the time of Jesus when Jesus was conceived. For example, it says like this, and her husband Joseph, being a just man and unwilling to put her to shame, resolved to divorce her quietly. When Joseph found out that Mary was pregnant, Joseph wanted to divorce her, but he could not divorce her quietly. That's what he was trying to do. But even though he was not married, he had to divorce her. That's how serious the engagement was. And then once this betrothal happens, and I am calling it engagement just for simplicity's sake. Once this engagement happens, it takes about 1 year for the wedding to happen. You may ask why it takes 1 year. During those times, the bridegroom will build an extension to the family background. They never left their homes. They just kept on building to the family background. So the bride can and the bridegroom can live in that family background. So it would take about a 1 year worth of time. And then once that construction happens, then the bridegroom asks the father for permission. Does this remind you of anything? If we understand this Jewish historical background, the Jewish wedding, many of the scriptures that Bible is talking about will make sense to us. For example, John chapter 14, Jesus said like this, "In my Father's house, there are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And once I prepare that place, I will gather you unto me." So what does that say? That's the bridegroom speaking. Jesus is our bridegroom. Jesus has gone to the Father's house, building a mansion for us so that we can live in eternity with Jesus Christ, our bridegroom. So that's what that scripture is talking about when you understand it from a Jewish wedding background. Here we see, after 1 year, with the permission of the father, the bridegroom with groomsmen would go to gather the bride. On their way, they'll always say like this, "Behold, bridegroom comes. Behold, bridegroom comes." But at that time, there were no telephone system. There is no electricity. The only way to convey something, it was to blow the trumpet or just saying out loud. But one of the ways for the bridegroom to announce to the bride that I'm coming is by saying, "Behold, the bridegroom comes." So that would happen. When the bride finally gets the message from someone, the bride would get ready. During this 1 year period of time, the bride will always have the wedding garments ready, anoint her with oil, and whatever other preparation that she would need to get ready for the bridegroom. Also, the lamb has to be ready because it will be a long journey to go to the bridegroom's home. You need to have a lamb that's ready and then extra oil as well. Because the oil will run out. The lamb is small, so you need to keep on filling the oil. But where you see here in Matthew chapter 25 verse 2, it says like this, "Now five of them were wise and five were foolish. Those who were foolish took their lamps and no oil with them." So five foolish virgins and five wise virgins. What made them foolish? What made them wise? The foolish virgins didn't have oil, extra oil for the journey. But the wise virgins had extra oil. That's what made them foolish and wise. Verse 5, it says like this, Matthew chapter 25, verse 5, if you want to follow along with me. But while the bridegroom was delayed, they all slumbered and slept. The bridegroom was delayed, so they all slept. They weren't prepared. They weren't ready. They thought, we have more time. We can prepare a little bit later. Everything is okay now. But then, verse 6, at midnight, a cry was heard. Behold, the bridegroom is coming. So a cry, a voice coming from faraway place. Bridegroom is coming, get ready. What did the virgins do? Then all those virgins prepared themselves and trimmed their lamps. The foolish virgins said to the wise, give us some of your oil. Our lamps are going out. The five virgins were shocked to find out that they are running out of oil. They've been waiting for the bridegroom, but when the bridegroom finally is about to arrive, they don't have oil. The wise virgin said, we cannot give you oil. We need oil for the long journey. If we give you the oil, we're not going to make it there. So go out and buy some for yourselves. Bible says like this, when the foolish virgins went out to buy the oil, the bridegroom came and took the wise virgins with him. By the time the foolish virgins came back, they were shocked. The bridegroom is already gone. They left. And after buying the oil, the five foolish virgins came to the wedding banquet hall. At that time, during that cultural time, the bridegroom and the bride would go into the wedding hall along with the groomsmen and the bridal party. And as soon as they arrive, they shut the door. Nobody is allowed to come in. Everybody else needs to stay outside until the wedding ceremony is finished. These foolish virgins came and knocked on the door. Lord, Lord, open to us. We are also the party of the bride. We just went to get the oil. We were just late. Open the door for us so we can participate in the wedding as well. But what did the bridegroom say? I don't know you. When I came, you weren't there. You weren't ready to come with me. So I don't know who you are. They're going to shut the door. That's what this parable is talking about. Jesus said like this, watch therefore, you know neither the day nor the hour in which the Son of Man is coming. Our Lord Jesus Christ is the bridegroom. Our Lord Jesus Christ is about to come to take the bride away. And the church, you and I, are the bride of Jesus. We need to be ready, have oil in our hands. What is oil symbolizes? Holy Spirit. We need the help of the Holy Spirit to be ready for the arrival of the bridegroom. If we don't live a life that is pleasing to God, if you don't have Jesus in your life, you will not be taken up into heavenly place with Jesus. Like I mentioned, Jesus is preparing a place for us. That's the language that Jesus has used. It's the language of the Jewish wedding. The audience at that time would understand what Jesus was talking about. Jesus is preparing a place for us. Bible says that Jesus will come. Like the bridegroom in this story came at the midnight hour when everybody was sleeping, Jesus came. Also, our bridegroom Jesus is about to come. Are you ready for his coming? If Jesus were to come tonight, are you ready? Are you listening to this message? If Jesus comes, are you ready for the arrival of our bridegroom Jesus? The whole world is pointing to the arrival of Jesus. Bible says like this, that in the end days, there will be wars and rumors of war. The whole world is on its edge. Many nations are getting ready to invade another nation. For example, as I am sharing this message with you, Russia may be getting ready to invade Ukraine. China may be getting ready to invade Taiwan. Many nations are fighting with each other. And a world catastrophe could happen. The world nations are preparing weapons that could destroy humanity in seconds or in minutes. The latest advances in the weaponry, hypersonic missiles, can reach from one end to the world, one end from another end within minutes, can destroy millions and millions of people. Nations will be destroyed. There are nuclear weapons that human beings has produced that can destroy the earth totally in minutes. When Jesus was talking about this 2,000 years ago, these weapons were not around. But now, all these weapons are ready. The world can be destroyed many times over, according to the scientist. Jesus said like this, and you will be hearing of wars and rumors of wars. See that you are not alarmed, for those things must take place, but that is not the end. For the nation will rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom. There will be famines, there will be earthquakes. There will be famine, Jesus said. There are a lot of famines that are happening. The prices of food is going up. People are struggling. Earthquakes are happening all over the place. Tsunamis are happening all over the place. We are in the midst of pandemics or pestilence that Jesus was talking about. There hasn't been a pandemic like this before, where millions and millions of people have passed away. Millions of people are suffering as a result of this pandemic. All these things are pointing to the arrival of our bridegroom, Jesus. What must you do to be saved? If you are not saved, listening to me, Bible says like this in the book of Romans chapter 10 verse 9. If you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. The number one thing that you must do is believe in your heart. What do you need to believe? That Jesus died for you on the cross of Calvary. On the third day, Jesus defeated the death and Jesus was resurrected, came out alive. On the cross of Calvary, Jesus paid, accepted the punishment that you are supposed to take. Jesus took the judgment on your behalf. Jesus carried all your sins and exchanged it with holiness. Jesus took away the judgment from you and exchanged it with eternal life for you. Instead of spending hell in hell, Jesus prepared heaven for you. And on the third day, Jesus resurrected and sitting on the right hand of the Father. You must believe that God has raised him from the dead. And you need to give your life to Jesus. You must confess that Jesus is Lord. In order for you to be saved, you must confess it and proclaim it aloud. That's number one. That is the basic and the basis of salvation. And then once you are saved, what do you need to do? You need to make public proclamation of your salvation experience. Jesus said like this, go into all the world, preach the gospel to every creature. Those who believe must be baptized. So after you believe, you must be baptized. Baptism is not to join a church, But baptism is to join with Jesus Christ. Baptism is to proclaim that you are a child of God. You have accepted Jesus Christ as the Lord and Savior of your life. And you are confessing it publicly. And you are testifying of the inward change that happened in your life outwardly. And then you must live a life that is worthy. Find a Bible-believing church. Find a group of people that worship in truth and in spirit, truly worshiping the living God, where you can grow in your Christian life. Because the bridegroom is about to come. Jesus Christ is about to come. This world is preparing for a destruction. Bible says like this, in the twinkling of an eye, without any warning, like a thief in the night. Thief will not announce the thief's arrival. Just like that, Jesus will come when nobody is expecting. But a trumpet will blow. Just like the groomsman will say, behold, the bridegroom comes. The angels will be blowing the trumpet, sound of God. A great shout will happen, behold the bridegroom. And the dead in Christ will rise first. Everyone, the people who dead in Christ, people who lived and died for Jesus, they will be quickly resurrected. And those who are alive will be caught up with him. And that's called rapture. You know, in the Jewish culture, after the wedding ceremony is over, the bride and the bridegroom will go into the wedding chamber. The bride will go in there first and close the door. And according to their culture, the bridegroom will follow her. But then bridegroom, since the door is locked, will knock on the door. One time, nobody will open. The second time, it will be opened again. The third time, the door will be knocked. And the bridegroom will say, behold, I'm standing at the door. I'm knocking on the door. Open the door and I will come in. Jesus said in the book of Revelation chapter 3 verse 20, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and open the door, I will come in. I will dine with him. Jesus wants to come into your heart. Would you open the door as you listen to this message? I don't know who you are listening to this message, but whoever you are, open the door. Jesus wants to spend eternity with you. Are you ready for the arrival of the bridegroom? And then the bride and the bridegroom will spend 7 days. 7 days in the wedding chamber. And only after the seventh day, the bride and the bridegroom will come out. In the meantime, the seventh day, people will be celebrating. They will be drinking and they will be eating. For example, the wedding of Cana was on the third day the wine ran out. It will be a 7 day long celebration. Bible says like this, when the rapture happens, in a rapture is a process where millions of people of God will be taken away. We will be spending 7 years with him, with our Lord Jesus Christ in heaven. And after the seventh year, there is going to be a wedding supper of the Lamb, Bible says. In heaven, there will be a great celebration. A marriage will take place between us and Jesus. A wedding ceremony will happen. It's called Wedding of the Lamb. After the seventh year, we will come back to rule this world for 1,000 years. That's what this parable is showing us. Parable is telling us that Jesus is about to come. Jesus is about to come. Jesus said in Matthew chapter 25 verse 13, watch therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour in which the Son of Man is coming. No one knows. If somebody says Jesus will come in 2022, May 11th or August 13th, they are preaching the false gospel. No one knows the hour or the time. But only one thing that we know is that all the signs are pointing to the imminent arrival of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Jesus is about to come. Are you ready? Whether you are ready or not, Jesus will come. If you are not ready, it will be tragedy waiting for you. Antichrist will rule this earth for 7 years. Satan himself will be ruling for 7 years. Can you imagine? Right now, Holy Spirit is controlling this world. But there will not be a Holy Spirit to control during this 7 year period of time after the church is taken away. Pure evil for the 7 years of time. Even now, can you imagine? The evil is even here now. These are the end times. Love of many is growing cold. When you read the newspapers, you can see fathers or children killing each other. Strangers are killing each other for money or for whatever reason. People are killing each other, murdering each other. Evilness is growing. But imagine when there is no Holy Spirit to control, what will happen? That's what's about to happen. Bible says there's the judgment. Judgment to reward the people of God who serve God. And the judgment of the wicked. What kind of judgment will you face? All of us will stand in the judgment day. All of us will stand and we need to be accountable for our life. When you stand in front of the Almighty God, there is no excuse. You cannot say, I've never heard the gospel. You cannot say, I didn't know anything about it. Because the Almighty God, all things are open in front of Him. If you serve Jesus, Jesus will reward you. If you did not, if you serve Jesus with a wrong motive, or if you didn't serve, if you have not accepted Jesus Christ, Jesus will say, depart from me, all you evildoers. And Jesus will judge you, sentence you to the lake of fire that has been prepared. But tonight I want to tell you, and I'm here to tell you to be ready for the coming of Jesus Christ. Make Jesus the Lord of your life. And live a life that is pleasing to God. That is what this parable is telling us. I pray that this message has been a blessing in your life. I pray that because of this message, people will be saved and delivered. And your life will be spent in eternity. God bless you so much. I hope and pray that you have been blessed by the message that you have heard. Just like that virgins, 5 of them were foolish, 5 of them were wise. Let us be like the wise virgins, anticipating the arrival of our Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus will come. Our life is short in this world. This world is being prepared for its destruction. But let us be ready for the arrival of Jesus. If you are not sure that you will spend your eternity in heaven with Jesus, please make Jesus the Lord of your life. That is the basics of Christian life. Surrender your life to Jesus. Bible says in Romans chapter 10 verse 9, if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that Jesus has been raised from the dead, God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. So today, make Jesus the Lord of your life. Find a church where Bible is being preached. If you need help in finding any church, please do call our prayer line. They can guide you to a church that is closer to you. Make Jesus the Lord of your life. Give your life to Him. If you honor God, God will honor you. This life is short. Bible says that our citizenship is not here. That we are not a citizen of India or America or China or Europe. No, our citizenship is in heaven. We need to be ready to go there anytime. If you are not sure, please pray with me. Make Jesus the Lord of your life. Pray along with me. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this blessed time. According to your word says, you have died for me on the cross of Calvary. You carried my sins. You took the judgment away from me. I give you my life. I make you, Lord Jesus, the Savior of my life. I give you and totally surrender my life to you. Thank you for making me a child of God. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. If you prayed with me, please do call one of the prayer partners. The numbers are on your screen. Please have them pray with you and let them guide you through the next step. May God bless you so much. Until I see you again, may God's presence be with you.